things of everybody sleeping off. We have started the day with the focus on this particular important day. As you know, this year we are focusing on the green part of the process, how we can make the job more greener as well as safer. But this was not the focus in earlier way. So we will be definitely interested to know how this particular day has started while we are making our journey to protect the people, property and environment. That is the purpose of all of us as we are here today. So a brief history from 2003, the focuses to which the promotion of safety, occupational safety and health has been traveling, and where we are focusing on the green economy. Last year, the focus was on occupational safety and health management system, a tool for continual improvement. Previous year, in 2010, it was emerging risks and new patterns of prevention in a changing world of work. 2009, it was health and life at work, a basic human right. And I will be also speaking today a little bit on the human right part, from taking cue from Professor Rantanen, who was the ICO president till last year, last triennium. Then 2008, it was my life, my work, my safe work, managing risk in the work environment. 2007, it was safe and healthy workplaces, making decent work a reality. As you know, the decent work agenda of ILO is a very, very important agenda, and of course many of us focus on improving the workplace, keeping that work agenda in mind. 2006, it was decent work, safe work, focusing on HIV/AIDS. 2005, it was creating and sustaining a preventive safety and health culture. 2004, it was creating and sustaining a safety culture. And 2003, since the year where ILO started supporting this initiative, or this day was safety and health culture in a globalized world. So it has traveled several years with different themes as we focus this year on the green economy. So my sharing will be on few important areas, like starting from decent work area to one case study at the end, where I will try to share how these thoughts have helped in an enterprise level to do something and which can be also replicated in a different form, perhaps in different other organizations, including the government organizations like railways, hospitals, and so many things. So it has a global perspective and a local application. So I am going to talk about the ILO decent work agenda, which says about that the work is central to people's well-being. That means lack of work sometimes may cause the lack of well-being as well. So we all know the many people who are not working, they are not necessarily very safe being at home, so it is also in work is actually, there have been many studies which says that work is actually invigorating, or it is creating more energy in the people. So it is very, very important to be at work. Now, it is also why it is work important, because apart from providing income, it can pave the way for broader social and economic advancement, strengthening individuals, their families and communities. Such progress, however, hinges on work that is decent. Of course, I was just hearing that day when I was in Mexico, somebody came and said that it is 3D work. You know what is 3D is meaning? He is meaning dangerous, demanding, and dirty. So somebody came and said that this work is 3D. Somebody was referring to a construction work where workers are exposed. They said it's 3D work. I was asking him, what is 3D work? He said, it is dangerous, it is dirty, and it is very, very demanding. Of course, we are talking about a different D, that is decent. The ILO has developed an agenda for the community of work. It provides support through integrated decent work country program developed in coordination with its constituents. Putting the decent work agenda into practice, it is achieved through the implementation of ILO's four strategic objectives. What is those four strategic objectives? The first objective is creating jobs. An economy that generates opportunities for investment, entrepreneurship, skills development, job creation and sustainable livelihoods. I think we all can play and are playing very important role in this area. Guaranteeing rights at work, to obtain recognition and respect for the rights of workers, all workers. I don't mean the people who do the job, the manual job or the job act through their, you know, we all are working in that sense. All workers at a particular disadvantage or poor workers, of course, need representation, participation, and laws that work for their interest. Now, corporate governance is with one step, I think, ahead to support this this part of the ILO strategic objective. Extending social protection to promote both inclusion and productivity by ensuring that women and men enjoy working conditions that are safe, allow adequate free time and rest, take into account family and social values, provide for adequate compensation in case of loss or reduced income, and permit access to adequate health care. And promoting social dialogue, that is the fourth strategic objective of ILO, involving strong and independent workers and employers' organizations, is central to increasing productivity, avoiding disputes at work, and building cohesive societies. Coming to promoting safety and health in a green economy, which is the focus, there are three sustainable development dimensions. One is economic growth, social equity, and environmental protection. So this is the focus. So green economy is more than sustainable economy. It is a society that preserves environment for future. It is more equitable, and it is inclusive of all people and countries. So what is a green job as per the various views from United Nations Environment Programme, the IOE, ITUC and ILO. So there is a green job initiative by all the four constituents who are supporting. It supports concerted efforts by governments, employers and trade unions to promote, in a climate challenge world, with environmentally sustainable and coherent policies and effective programs that are also aimed at generating green jobs and decent work for all. So here are, what are the initiatives, like ease the transition process, new opportunities are created and shared by employers, workers, other social actors, improve social security, new and more integrated policies, enhance workers' education and skills, develop sustainable enterprises, boost employment creation. I think there are, each area is a big focus, can be a big focus area, and we can work in each areas, I think, to support and sustain the growth of this dimension. Now, the Green Jobs Initiative defines recent work which contributes directly to reducing the environmental impact of enterprises, economic sectors, or the economy as a whole by reducing energy and resource consumption, reducing emissions, waste, and pollution, and by preserving or restoring ecosystems. Green jobs need to be decent work. That is, good jobs which offer adequate wages, safe working environment conditions, job security, reasonable career prospects, and workers' rights. So a lot of things together, and I think we are mostly focusing today on safe working conditions, but I think all of us can do a little bit on the other areas as well. ILO focuses reinforce joint efforts for an economically efficient, socially just, and environmentally sound transition to green economy, green jobs creation, and the promotion of sustainable enterprises, the development of an institutional and political just transition framework, the extension of social protection systems, and the promotion of social inclusion in green economy policies. The inclusion of workers and employers' organizations and labor market institutions in governance and implementation mechanisms. So there are, as you know, there are many ILO conventions. We are not going to discuss all of them, but we are going to discuss or mention about the very important ILO conventions, which is a few of the ILO conventions. For example, Occupational Safety and Health Convention number 155, Recommendation number 164, 1981, Protocol of 2002, to the Occupational Safety and Health Convention number 155, which was released in 2002. List of Occupational Diseases Recommendation number 194 in 2002. Occupational Health Service Convention number 161 and Recommendation number 171 in 1985. promotional framework of occupational safety and health convention number 187 and recommendations number 197 in 2006 and guidelines on occupational safety and health management system ILOSH. All these are freely downloadable material from the net. If you go to ILO website, you will be able to see all of them. And in fact, if anyone wish to have it, in fact, Dr. Shah has downloaded many of these things in the CD which is provided or being provided today. So there are conventions aiming at few hazardous industries, including ship breaking industries, international convention for the safe and environmentally sound recycling of ships, which is IMO 2009-19. Safety and healthy ship breaking guidelines for Asian countries and Turkey, ILO 2004-20. Mining, safety and healthy mines convention number 176 and recommendation number 183-1995. Code of practice on safety and healthy open cast mines, which has been released by ILO in 1991. Code of practice on safety and health in underground coal mines, ILO 2006. So agriculture, forestry, I am not going through the whole of the list, but there have been a lot of conventions which are relating to various sectors of the economy. Now in construction sector, we have safety and health in construction convention number 167 and recommendation number 175 1988, code of practice on safety and health in construction ILO 1992. Again, it is a downloadable document. You can get it free from ILO website and can be very useful in the practicing safety professionals. Asbestos convention number 162 and recommendation number 172 1986. Code of practice on safety and health in the use of asbestos by ILO in 1984. And then I would like to mention about our national policy, which came in the 2009, and we are very glad that Mr. Chatterjee, the deputy director from our DG Fasli, has kindly come, and he will be available in the interactive session, panel discussion before the end of the day. We will be having, which is very important, and which will be helpful in bringing the action plan which we are going to derive today. And in this this national policy is applicable across the sections of various various industries, all sectors, in fact. And I feel it is very important that we all know what is the policy and how what is our responsibility to implement the policy at every level. So I am not going through the policy as such. It will take a huge time, but we just want to highlight that it connects to the Indian Constitution, the Constitution of India, which provides detailed provision for the right of the citizen and also lays down the directive principles of state policy, which set to aim to which the activities of the states are to be guided. These directive principles provide for securing the health and strength of employees, men and women, that the tender age of children are not abused, the citizens are not forced by economic necessity to enter vocations unsuited to their age or strength. Just and human conditions of work and maternity relief are provided, and that the government shall take steps by suitable legislation or any other way to secure the participation of employees in the management of undertakings, establishments and other organizations engaged in any industry. Government of India firmly believes that without safe, clean environment as well as healthy working conditions, social justice and economic growth cannot be achieved, and the safe and healthy working environment is recognized as a fundamental human right. Education, training, consultation and exchange of information and good practices are essential for prevention and promotion of such measures. The fundamental purpose of this national policy on safety, health and environment at workplace is not only to eliminate the incidence of work-related injuries, diseases, fatalities, disaster and loss of national assets, and ensuring achievement of a high level of occupational safety, health and environment performance through proactive approaches, but also to enhance the well-being of the employee and society at large. The necessary changes in this area will be based on a coordinated national effort focused on clear national goals and objectives. Then coming to occupational health as human rights, I mentioned in the beginning that I will take the views or the teach learnings which I received from Professor Bjorma Rantanen during the last IPO Congress in Mexico. He was very emphatically talking about the human rights and this is excerpt from his speech. He mentioned that in the human rights development, two trends are recognized: extension of coverage towards universality, and expansion of content from basic survival rights to decent quality of life rights, including health and safety at work. The ILO Constitution in 1999 first stipulated on workers' rights, which were further amplified and expanded to the 1966 UN International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, ICESCR, which exclusively stipulated the workers' right to work safely and healthy at work, health care and social protection. There is a wide implementation gap in the application of international and national instruments like ILO conventions, which as such are adequate if implemented. Naturally, if we implement all these conventions, even all our legislation is available, I think we will be achieving the human rights and whatever requirements we are talking today fully. About 500 million workers in the morning, I think we heard that, are having access to only 500 million people have the access to OHS, while about 80 to 85% people, that means around 3 billion workers of the world do not have access to occupational health services, including several vulnerable and high-risk groups. So out of the 500 million people, there may be many people who are not very vulnerable, but they are working in a very different economy. They are working in big multinationals, so they have access. But there are many people who are working in a high-risk area, but they do not have access to the occupational health and safety services. The vast majority of the 2.3 million fatalities caused by occupational factors annually do occur among these non-served sectors. Most of the work